7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, are you ready?
Good evening, everyone. My name is Jason Palmer, one of the hosts and creators of this show, What's Up, Cuz? We're going to do a little bit of a different introduction this evening in light of the things that are happening in our world, specifically the unfortunate case out of Memphis, Tennessee, here in the United States, where a young man by the name of Tyree Nichols lost his life after he was beaten to death by members of the Memphis Police Department. When Lance Irvin, my cousin, and I started this show, in July of 2020, we did so after the unfortunate murders of George Floyd and Breonna Taylor by members of American law enforcement. We started this show as part of the social justice initiatives and changes that were being made around the country. And we wanted to provide an outlet for African Americans and our allies to be able to speak directly to the Black community in issues revolving sports and social issues going on in the world. In light of what happened in Memphis and what we are now seeing as the wheels of justice begin to slowly turn, Lance and I just want to send our sincere condolences to the family of Tyree Nichols. Our prayers and thoughts are with the people in Memphis, Tennessee, as they get ready to go through some months of really gut-wrenching, soul-searching stuff as this investigation takes place. Before we came on the air, it was just announced that in addition to 6 Memphis police officers who have been fired as a result of this incident, 3 Memphis Fire Department employees, 2 paramedics, and 1 lieutenant have also been dismissed of their duties after an investigation found they did not properly assess Tyree Nichols' injuries when they arrived on the scene last month. We are hopeful, as always, that change and moving forward is taking place in this country, but we also understand how slowly the wheels of justice can turn. Lance and I started this show with a mission. We're continuing the show with this mission. And while we will be discussing sports with our guests tonight, we could not start this show without acknowledging what has happened in Memphis, Tennessee. As always, we appreciate you tuning in. We appreciate you following us on Twitter. We appreciate all the support we have gotten, and we appreciate Maya Akai and Sean Sierra, creators of Sports Zone Chicago, for providing us this platform to bring this show to you. And with that said, let's start tonight's edition of What's Up, Cuz. So with that said, I'd like to bring in, he is my co-host and my real life cousin, who sometimes gets on my nerves, but you know, for the most part, he's a pretty good guy. Lance Irvin, what's up, cuz? How you doing today?
What's up, cuz? I mean, I'm doing good, but I appreciate how you started off the show tonight. I think Tyree Nichols has been on the mind of a lot of us across this country and across America. And just want to say a prayer for his family. I mean, it's an unfortunate situation that what happened to him happened in 2023. And in the end, I'm a father, and I want my daughter, she's a kid, she's a child, to come back home safely. Mm-hmm. And for 5 individuals to do what they did to him, that's bad. That is bad to kick a young man while he's defenseless on the ground and do the things that they did to him. It's unbelievable. And I don't know if they went through sensitivity training. I don't know what. But it's an unfortunate situation. It just has to stop. So we just continue to pray for America and pray for Tyree Nichols' family.
Yeah, I mean, this was a very tragic situation to see the photo of this young man as he was laying in the hospital, you know, days before he eventually succumbed to his injuries. It was heartbreaking for Black and brown communities all around the world. You know, we constantly see this stuff being done by law enforcement here in America. And we have to change the culture of the law enforcement community. That's all there is to it. They have to change the way they deal with the public as a whole. You know, I cover a lot of this stuff. And while this does not just, this is not exclusive to Black and brown communities, it just happens at such a disparaging rate. But I can tell you incidents of Caucasian people who have been injured and killed by police too unjustly. So this is a cultural problem that America needs to really get a hold of. Because watching this, the video of that was really, I honestly couldn't sleep Friday night after I watched that, Lance. And I had to be up at 7 o'clock in the morning. I got 2 hours of sleep.
No, I was only able to watch about 3 to 5 minutes, Jay, because I was sick to the stomach. And I also sat there and I said, if I'm there watching four people kick, punch, hit an individual, I owe it to myself and the community to say, y'all cut it out. Mm-hmm. Stop it. Like at some point in time, someone has to say, stop it. I understand that's a stressful job. I think you and I both understand. Being a police, when you work in the public, it can be stressful. But at some point in time, you know, it's a human element to everything that goes on. It's a spiritual element to me to when stuff goes on, right? And one of them, all I had to do was say, come on, y'all, let's stop. I've been in a situation where guys was about to fight and do other stuff, Jay. And I was able to say, no, not this. We're not doing this. And they stopped. So at some point in time, someone has to have sense enough to say stop.
Well, and I agree with you, Lance. I mean, we grew up in Chicago. We've been involved in fights. Okay. Exactly. But at a certain point, we all kind of know when it's time to end the fight and when you could go to this next step. You know, when I was watching that video, what I actually thought was about was the classic movie Coolie High.
Oh man, love
at
that
the,
movie.
At the love end, it. Where them dudes beat Cochise and basically beat him to death. That is basically what I saw in this video. It was almost like art imitating life. Mm-hmm. You know, that no one there said, okay, you know what, this is enough, we shouldn't be doing this, blah blah blah. No one did that. No one cared about this man's humanity. And I think that was the most disappointing thing of it all. And so earlier this afternoon, Memphis announced the firing of this particular officer as well. This is Officer Preston Hemphill. He deployed his taser on Tyree. But I think what was very damaging was what Officer Hemphill was heard saying on the video when he was the one after Mr. Tyree had run away. He said, that's why I hope when they catch up with him, I hope they stomp his ass. And he said it twice. So I think his own words is about to get him in a whole lot of trouble, because now this thing can escalate to first degree murder charges, because now you have... You're now setting the qualification of, well, we planned this thing. So, you know, this is going to be very interesting going forward. United States Justice Department, they haven't announced it, but they're going to do a violation of his civil rights violations. So there's going to be a lot going on with this case in the weeks and the months to come. And America, the whole world is watching to see how you handle this.
And Jason, every now and then, when they get fired, right, do they keep benefits and all that other stuff like that? Because sometimes I hear people say, how do they get to keep their benefits after something like this happens?
Well, you know, it really all depends, because I think each department, you know, they all got different unions and they all negotiate different things with the cities or the counties or the states that they are working for. So I'm not averse to say what can happen in Memphis. But for these particular individuals, they got fired for doing some real high illegal stuff. I can't imagine them keeping them benefits, but again, I don't know their contract. So we'll see. So, all right. Now that we have spoken on this issue, let's talk about our show. Welcome everybody to What's Up, Cuz. I am your host, Jason Balmer, along with my cousin, Lance C. Irvin. For those of you tuning in on the Facebook Live feed, we appreciate you tuning in there. Go ahead and send us a holler or ask us questions if you want. If you're tuning in on the Sports Zone Chicago YouTube channel, go ahead and like and subscribe to that channel. It'll give you access to all the shows we have here on Sports Zone Chicago. If you are tuning in the Roku Forum, if you got Roku and you're tuning in on the Sports Zone Chicago Roku channel. We appreciate you tuning in there. That's how you can see us anywhere in the world where you are. And we look at the stats and see where we are big. And we got people watching us in London, Lance Irvin. And I was like, oh, all right, that'll work. So people are tuning in all over the world for our show. We appreciate that. And if you're on the go and you still want to tune in to us, you can do that too by downloading the Sports Zone Chicago app. If you do not have the app, my cousin Lance is about to tell you where you
can. And if you don't have the app, you can tune in at the iTunes store, the Amazon store, and the Google Play store. And, you know, make sure you follow us on all our social media platforms. And normally I ask my cousin Jason what's up with his shirt that he has on. First, I'm going to start off with my turtleneck that my wife Paula bought me.
Ooh. Oh!
Yeah, you know, my boo Paula bought me this. So shout out to my wife. I'm going to give her a shout out. But, Jay, is that the Chicago? Is that the sky you wear?
It is the Chicago sky I'm wearing. I am wearing a Chicago sky shirt. And you know why I'm saying?
Does it have a park on the back? Like, where's the Candace Parker jersey? Where's the farewell Candace Parker jersey? Like, where's number three? Where's CP3? Where's the other CP3?
I do not have Parker on the back of this one.
Why not?
Because she's no longer with the damn Chicago Sky, apparently, Lance Irvin. The Chicago Sky are losing Candace Parker, best known as CP3, one of our own. She will be reportedly signing with the Las Vegas Aces, the defending WNBA champions. She will be leaving Chicago after two seasons, but she did bring us a title here in 2021. But we are just heartbroken to hear this news, and we wish the best for Candace. These are photos that I took of her, and that is our girl, Kalia Copper, next to her. This was at the parade in the city celebration when we won the title in 2021. You can see the trophy is there, and Candace was a free agent. I thought there was a chance she was going to retire or re-sign with the Sky. I did not think she would leave the Sky and go play with another team. I was actually kind of surprised she's gone.
I think we all were a little shocked, right? I think, personally, I just thought she was coming back. And I forgot she was a free agent. But when she picked the Las Vegas Aces, I was like, ooh, she just pulled a boss move, Jay. You know why it was a boss move, Jay? Because she went out there and joined Aja Wilson, Chelsea Plum. She went out there and joined a crew. Kelsey Plum, excuse me, and Chelsea Gray. She went out there and joined a crew. And if I'm not mistaken, the Aces won it last year, right, Jay?
Yeah,
let's see if they can run it back to back. Picking up Candace Parker was huge, Jay. But what's up with our Chicago Sky? Stevens is a free agent. Mess was a free agent. Parker was a free agent. I mean, it's going to be interesting with old James Wade. Has to pull off these days because if they lose those other two, and matter of fact, your girl Vandersloop is a free agent, if I'm not mistaken. So it could get real quiet for the Sky quick. You lose those four, Jay. I know they got a championship, but if you lose those four, hey, I don't know.
I think they are now revamping their team. That's what I think. I think the signal. Like you said, Vandersloot is a free agent. Stevens is a free agent. They got some work to do. I don't know how they're going to do this. This is going to be real interesting to me.
Interesting. They basically blew the team up. How it goes. They had, what was it, a firestorm or whatever they call it? They blew the team up.
Well, I think you still have pieces. Well, here's one thing. I think Dana Evans is getting ready to have a breakout season. Okay, I think she's going to take over the point guard role. In her exit meetings at the end of last season, she expressed to James Wade in no uncertain terms, yo, I'm ready. I need to be starting now. Let's go. And I love Vandersloot. You know that. But Dana Evans, I also think, is going to be a hell of a player in this league. And I think her defense and her youth could have served the Sky more last season, especially in the playoffs. I understand why James went with his horses, but I don't think you can keep Dana Evans down much longer. And she didn't already express, yo, I need to play. So I don't think Vandersloot is coming back, but this is going to be very interesting to see what they do.
I was about to say, talking to you from my coach's seat, right? First of all, you need veterans. You need veterans. You lose Candace Parker. If Mess leaves, you lose two of the best 5'4", 4'5" passing big ladies in the WNBA that could go inside and outside. They could shoot threes. They spread the floor. You lose Vandersloot. And if you lose Stephen Jay, I just think that's a lot to overcome when you lose your whole front line, and all those young ladies are pretty good. So it's going to be interesting to see what they can pick up in free agency. Unless they can pick up Breonna Stewart, it's going to be really tough. I know Dana Evans. I love Dana Evans. I watched her play when she was in high school, followed her in Louisville, watched her whole career. But you and I both know, you lose those four integral pieces. Maybe Stevens will sign back. I don't know. But Vandersloot, like you said, she'll probably go to Seattle from what I've been reading, or New York. But, Jay, that's a lot of pieces to be losing in 1 year.
It is. So it's going to be a major overhaul, and you need the players that are currently on your roster. I mean, you still got Copper. You still got Cop. I mean, she's one of the best players in the league. They still going to have a squad, but he's got some work to do. And I'm not saying they can't compete again for another championship this year, but you're going to have to do it through free agency. I think they got a draft pick this year. I think those guys got a draft pick. You're going to have to do well in the draft. You're going to have some rookies step up and do some phenomenal stuff. I still think, you know, they'll probably be a playoff team if he can fill in some of these pieces. But, you know, it's hard to get a championship in any sport. And I don't see that in 2023. But, you know, we'll see what James do. He's a pretty creative guy.
He is. He is creative. He's a really good coach. And, like, he's been able to assemble good teams. So let's see if he can continue to keep the ball rolling, excuse me. But we know he has his work to do, though. Ooh, he has some work to do.
Yeah, without a doubt. So we'll see what happens. Coming up on tonight's show, we forgot to tell the people who's coming on tonight. That's my bad. I slipped up on that. Man, we got a great show tonight. You know that?
Man, I figured it'd be decent. You said great. So what's so great about it? You know, it's normally always great. But, you know, I normally call it great after the show because, like, who's on the show tonight? Like,
man, we got an incredible guest tonight. The Chicago Bears, they're always the hot sports topic here in Chicago. And they made news a couple weeks ago as they bring in a new president and CEO, Mr. Kevin Warren, who is the former Big Ten commissioner. There he is, Brother Kevin Warren. And I was like, let me call my cousin. I like, hey, cuz, Kevin Warren said in the press conference that his first client when he was an NFL agent was a man by the name of Chris Zorich. And I said, wait a minute, Chris Zorich, that's also the guy who hired my cousin to his first Division I head coaching job. Hey, man. See if you can get him on the show, and lo and behold, you came through once again. Coming up tonight at 6:30, Chris Zorich, Notre Dame and Chicago Bears alum, will be joining us to talk about his relationship with Kevin Warren, what's going on with the Chicago Bears, what he's doing now. And the thing I always liked about Chris is that he always did stuff in the community when he was a player, and well, and after he was no longer a player, he stayed true to his Southside roots. So Chris is coming on at 6:30.
Wow, Chris Zorich, 5-0. You know how they used to say Avery Johnson is called Dave Robson 5-0. We got the real 5-0. Ooh, he used to put a hurting on people when he's in the NFL and a good old Notre Dame. So happy to have Chris on. You know, that gentleman, Jay, you know, I think I'm as big as Chris Zorich now. You know, Chris used to walk around office like he lifted, right? I used to say, man, Chris, I can lift just as much as you can. You know, like guys like him and Sean think, because, you know, they're a little bit bigger than I am. I can lift just as much as those guys.
Okay, you know? You cannot lift with football players. I
don't fool yourself. I'm just wiry strong. You know, Chris will tell you, you know. Sean is hesitant to ask me to go out lifting.
You're
with him,
wiry right? strong.
I'm
Please
wiry strong.
This.
I'm wide receiver. See, guys like the Super Back and Chris Zorich, you know, those guys, they look like they all buff and all big and swole and all that. When you wiry strong, those stuff, wiry, you know, I could lift the same weights as they can. Man, just goes up a little easier. You know, my body is built a little different than those guys. They know it. We ask both of them. They understand. They benching 315. I bench 3. Oh, my fault. I didn't know Sean was on. What's up, Sean?
See, the only problem is that you ain't trying to get up at 5 o'clock in the morning to lift with me. That's what I'm saying. See, I don't just lift anymore. I do what's CrossFit, that? So we do some other stuff. So, you know, but you got to get up at, you know, 4 o'clock in the morning like I do to get to the studio by 5. So I don't think you know, are you ready to get up at 4 o'clock in the morning? You know what I'm saying? Are you ready to get up at 4 o'clock in the morning?
I'm never one to turn down a challenge, so I get at you next month. I get at you in February. I'm gonna come out there. I don't want to turn down a challenge. I'm gonna show you how this wiry strong guy does.
Oh, see that? See, I'm gonna have to get up in the morning and come see. Well, you know what? I'm usually already up. So
here's what's gonna happen. Every month or 6 weeks or maybe even 2 months, they have bring a friend week. So all day that week at CrossFit, you could bring a friend, no charge, and they just go through the workout with you. So the next time. There is a bring a friend week. They'll give us advance notice. So I'll give you notice. So you can go start working out and, you know, getting used to, you know, maybe some little high activity, you know, high rep, you know, movements. I'll give you more than 2 weeks notice. So you get probably 3 weeks, maybe a month's notice, but at least 3 weeks. So you can start getting this because I don't want, you know, you having to call Jason like, Jason, Sean tried to kill me. Sean tried to kill me. He had me deadlifted. No way. See, you know.
Jason, does the Superback know who's he talking to? Matter of fact, I'm sending him some photos. I'm always ready. I'm always ready. I can't wait. Okay. I can't wait.
I'll be there with the medical kit, Sean.
No.
Thank
I'll
you.
Be there on a Saturday, and I'll be there one day during the week. Doing a week.
Oh,
medical kit for who? I'm a trained professional killer when it comes to that. they don't call me the little beast for nothing around here. The little beast, that's what they used to call me in the weight room, all the schools I played for. What schools I work for. They go little beast in here.
Oh, this is gonna be interesting.
I'm not denying your skills. I'm not denying your strength. Because you
like
you got some strength. I'm just saying.
I can't wait to get you and Chris on at the same time.
It's a different
Chris,
workout, man. That's
Chris
all I'm saying.
Saw me in the weight room lifting. Hey, Jay, we're gonna bring him and Chris on at the same time. We're gonna bring the super back because the guys look strong in stature. Wiry strong.
You country strong when I'm country strong? Okay. I'm not doubting it at all by any stretch.
I like that.
I'm just saying.
I'm coming.
All I'm saying is I would be very anxious to see and have you show off your strength.
but Sean, let me ask you really quick question.
I can't believe you're challenging a football player this, but okay.
That's not a challenge. If you're confident in your skills and strength like I am, because I'm not worried about all that. I can hold mine on. But anyway, Sean, let me ask you a quick question. I just got to ask you. The last play of the Bengals and Chiefs game.
Oh, Lord. You about to set him off for 30 minutes.
What happened? Could the guy have pulled up? I mean, did he just lose it when he pushed him out of bounds? Like, did he think he was going to turn the corner or what?
I have no defense for that dude. That was the dumbest play in the world. you knew you're on just outside their kicker's field goal range.
Right.
There was no reason to do that. It was out of frustration. It was out of stupidity. And then, man, karma got his ass quick because you saw it looked like he hyperextended his knee on that play. I was like, oh, snap, because I saw it as it happened. I'm like, oh, he might be down. And sure enough, he was down. Luckily, he avoided major injury, but he was down for a quick second. If you watched the replay, his knee hyperextended. I'm like, ooh, brain fart. Nothing more, nothing less. Just stupid football play. And I don't know if you saw the video. After the game, when they're going in the locker room, one of the teammates was like, he was yelling at him. He goes, "Man, why you touch that quarterback? Why you ever touch that quarterback?
This is my last year." Yeah, he's like, man, it's my last year.
Yeah,
my last effing year.
Yeah,
I mean, like Sean, that's why I said I couldn't wait to have you on the show because I'm watching and I'm like, They're out of field goal range. Yeah. It's like with the little yard, I thought you know better than me, Sean. With the little amount of yardage that he picked up on that play, he's out of bounds. Just leave him alone.
Yeah, he got the first down, which is what you know people were surprised at. But then you when you pushed him out of bounds, and then don't get me wrong, you know, Patrick Mahomes did a little LeBron James. He threw his hands up. He's like, ah! I heard the scream. Like, ah! Yeah. And
he sold it.
And here come the whistles. But you know what? Earlier, I was upset with that game. I thought that they had it preordained that the Chiefs were going back. There are just far too many calls against the Bengals. And don't get me wrong, the Bengals made enough stupid calls on their plays on their own where it blended in. Where you know there's a lot of people saying no, it's not fixed. So the Bengals shot themselves in the foot a lot.
Okay,
but they said another thing. Remember the third down play where they did over?
Yeah.
Okay. They said, and I said, don't look me in the eye, piss on my shoes, and tell me it's raining. So this is the explanation they said. They said the official blew the whistle, which you saw they showed. He said, but he said he didn't want to get hurt, so he had to go. And they said they couldn't hear the whistle because the crowd was too loud. I said, and people are like, oh, okay, I get it. And I said, hold on, player. Hold on. The Chiefs had the ball. The Chiefs are calling the plays. Crowd ain't going to get loud when the Chiefs are calling the plays. The home crowd quiets down when the home team has the ball.
Exactly.
Until the play is over or until a great play is made. You know, they're not going to be like, when was the last time you saw a quarterback come in and like, remember quarterback used to go like this all the time when they're telling the crowd to get down? Crowds were didn't realize they're hurting their own team. They don't do that anymore. So when you sit there and tell me, oh, it was too loud to hear. Too loud to hear, you guys had the ball. There's no way the crowd was that loud. Not saying that there wasn't a buzz, no. But when you have the ball, the crowd is not going to be as loud as it was if Joe Burrow had the ball on a key fourth down situation late in the game. I was like, right. don't give me that BS.
It was not a good day for the officiating crew. But, you know, Sean, again, I've told you this 2 years ago, when all those experienced referees kind of left at the same time, I said, you're going to see the residual effect of this in the years coming down the road because they've now got more inexperienced people who are now wearing the white hat. Like, okay, you got a ref now. What? I mean, they lost Ed Hockley. They lost like a whole lot of people like within a 12-month period. Yeah. And that has a profound effect. Just like like you just said, Lance, if the Sky lose all these players this year, it's going to have a profound effect on the team. Well, if it's happening in the officiating community, it's going to have a profound effect on the quality officials that you get in all sports. And again, we're already seeing this on the high school level because it's such a shortage of referees and it's people working matches where I'm like, good Lord, I'm glad I ain't coaching no more because I've seen this person referee before. Well, I work with them and I'm like, I wouldn't be happy. So, I mean, it's the officiating community right now. We're going through a lot on the lower levels and you're seeing it at the upper echelon of sports too. I mean, again, we talked about the baseball umpiring situation and how long it took for Joe West to finally leave, not be terminated or they say, Joe, take another job. Just he was like, okay, I'm going to quit now. And, you know, you still got Angel Hernandez who's in Major League Baseball umpiring. So, you know, you got a lot of stuff going on in the officiating community, the NBA officials, 3-and-8 refs just sued the NBA over the COVID vaccine mandate. So this, I mean, I can't lie. That's a lot of stuff going on in our industry right now. And unfortunately, we're starting to see some of this affect what is going on in the game. But hey, we have approached our first break. Yeah, this is our first break. So we're going to take some commercial breaks. And then Lance and I will be right back. You are watching What's Up, Cuz.
Got it done here. Ouch! And we're gonna make sure you lit this time. Ouch! You're not gonna get me this time.
Ouch, Manny!
Oops. try an easy one.
From Iraq and Afghanistan, our brave warriors are coming home, wounded. Some with wounds you can see, some with wounds you can't see. Wounded Warrior Project was created to support our men and women coming off the battlefield. Please help carry these warriors the rest of the way home. Get involved at woundedwarriorproject.org.
Hey, this is Dr. J, and I listen to Sean and Maya in the morning.
Everybody, to What's Up, Cuz. I'm your host, Jason Palmer, along with my cousin, the coach himself, Lancey Irvin. And we are ready to welcome our first guest of tonight's show. And I'm so excited when we're going to talk to him in just a few minutes. We saw him back in the green room. He had to step out real quick. But Lance, let me just say this. In regards to the Bulls, because the trade deadline is coming up. And we've all gone back and forth with what the heck are we going to do with the Chicago Bulls? Are we trading people? Are we just keeping them? Are we waiting for Lonzo Ball to come back? Is he going to be our savior? What the hell would you do if you're Chicago Bulls right now?
I mean, it's tough right now. Zach is under contract. He signed that big extension. So you really not going to move Zach, and I don't know if you could move him. And DeMar is such an integral piece of the team. Like, it's tough moving him. I probably almost, Jay, wait to see if Alonzo comes back, because last year when he played, Jay, they had a really good year. He's an integral part of their team on the defensive end. He orchestrates on the offensive end, and he brings some more size to the team that they need. I've always been concerned about the inside play. They have Andre Drummond, and they have Vuk, but I think they need a longer stretch four man that can help them space the court a little bit more, even though Vuk's drift outside a little bit. I've always been concerned about their length. But at this point in time, Jay, other than maybe getting a longer four man, I wouldn't trade none of the guys at this point, Jay. Because how can you trade DeMar, Zach, maybe Coby White. Maybe Coby White, but I don't know what type of pieces you can get for Coby White. So that's the part that's interesting to me, Jay. It's going to be interesting, but if I picked up anything, it'd probably be a long stretch for that can play some defense because their defense has been awful this year. Let me not say awful. It's been inconsistent. Mm-hmm. So that's a tough situation right there. But I think they will hold. What would you do?
I've been quite vocal what I would do with the Bulls. And, you know, I've traded Zach all the way back in the preseason. So I just think his chemistry, I think the Bulls' main problem is their chemistry. That's what I think. I think they got two main problems, their chemistry and their team defense. Their team defense, like you say, it's not consistent. The other thing I see about this team is that they play when they want to play. When they playing against the big teams, all of a sudden they, you know, diving for balls. They doing all sorts of stuff. As they, you know, they've beaten Boston. They've beaten Milwaukee. Mm-hmm. You know, they beat a lot of top teams. Mm-hmm. And then you go and you lose Orlando. You go and you lose to San Antonio or Dallas. You lose to the bottom feeders. And I'm like, what are we doing here? So I think the main problem with the Bulls is they got some chemistry issues.
And I don't think they have a clear-cut leader. I'm not still trying to figure out. I think Io is developing into one, but he's still younger, and he doesn't make as much money as some of those guys make. So that's going to be a problem.
Is that a factor in leadership in NBA locker rooms?
It shouldn't be, but from what I hear, sometimes it might be. From what I remember, I was talking to Kendall Gill about leadership. And, you know, we were talking about that, and Kendall Gill was like, sometimes when you're just coming into the league and you're not making as much money as some of those other guys make, it can be difficult. So, you know, that may be coming into play, but I don't know if they have a vocal leader. Mm-hmm. I don't know. And when you ask people, if you listen to Stacey King talk, and if you listen to some of the other guys in the studio, one thing they keep talking about is leadership. You know, Billy Donovan can only do so much.
Right.
But I'm not sure from a leadership standpoint who can keep them engaged, who can tell somebody, hey, look, you're not playing hard enough. Come on, y'all, let's do this. Let's do this. Because I haven't heard, I don't think Zach is a leader. And DeMar seems like he's a quiet assassin to me.
Right, right.
So they need some more veteran leadership for sure. So whoever that is, and whoever they could bring in to provide some leadership would probably help.
I agree with that. I think they definitely are missing a leader, someone who can really push them, because these seasons are long. You know, it's a long NBA season once you include the preseason and all this stuff. But I just think when I'm seeing the inconsistency in the effort that these players are putting out there, that is a leadership issue. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I mean, I think Lonzo Ball is the leader of the team. Mm-hmm. I've always thought that when I was watching him last year, and then when he went down in the middle of the season, I was like, oh man, it's going to be interesting to see how they go from here and if they can recover. But they're a very peculiar group. That's the best way I can describe the Chicago Bulls, the peculiar group, because they've got a lot of talent. And we've talked to a lot of people who are around this team on a regular basis, who talk to these players, who know their personalities and what makes them tick. And even they can't give us an answer. You know, we talked to Kendall. We've talked to our guy Eugene. We've talked to a whole lot of Joseph Phillips. We talked to a lot of people about this team, and everybody's just like, I don't know.
Yeah, that's the million-dollar question, and I think if it was one surefire answer, that button would have been pressed right now. And, you know, you have to look at Coach Donovan, seeing if he is pressing the right buttons. I think he's a really good coach, but at some point in time, it falls on the players, too. They're out there. They have a job to do. They need to bring it each and every day. Like, you use the word talented. Well, at some point in time, you got to show how talented you really are. And this has been a full year. We have no excuse. Everybody's traveling. Everybody playing the same amount of games. We haven't heard anything about the vaccine. I haven't heard about anything about players missing too many games. Mm-hmm. At some point in time, Jay, after 50 games, you are what you are. So, nah, come on now. You need to figure it out.
I agree. All right, hey, you ready to bring on our first guest?
Man, our first guest? Yeah, so you want me to talk about our first guest?
Yeah, talk about it. You do the introduction.
I will save the part about me outlifting him and Sean for later during the show. But, this guy attended CVS High School. He went on to Notre Dame, Jay, where I think he was a two-time All-American, UPI Lineman of the Year. Jay went on to play for the Chicago Bears, Jay, Pro Bowl alternate. He wore number 5-0, Jay. He worked at Prairie State. He was the AD at Chicago State. And he did his best work when he hired me, Jay. But I'm not gonna live on that. What you laughing for?
I'm sorry.
He played for Notre Dame and played for Lou Holtz, and he's a great guy, Jay. You know, we always about bringing on good people.
That's
he's
right.
He's a really, 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 really good person. So let's bring Chris Zorich out, Jay.
Chris, how you doing? Welcome to What's Up, Cuz, man.
I'm doing good, Lance. Thank you for the introduction. I appreciate it.
Hey, Chris, but now let me do this. I kind of have a bone to pick with you because I saw the College 16 podcast that you did.
Okay.
And your intro music for that show was fire, Chris.
Man, I got my boy doing it. It was amazing, man.
Hey, Chris, it was amazing. I listened and I was sitting there like, oh, dang, we need to feel that. So we need to talk about the music. Man, Chris, it's great to see you. How have you been doing?
Thank you very much, man. It's so good seeing you. Jason, it's a pleasure meeting you, man.
You too, Chris. You too. Thank you so much for joining us.
Absolutely, man. I'm here to have some fun.
But let's have some fun, Christian. You'll figure out this show is a little bit different than some of the other shows that you'll be on. But no, Chris, so talk to us about what have you been doing lately? I know you were the AD. Now you work for Randall Parker. I mean, his partner's executive search firm. Talk to us about what that is and what you do for them.
Sure. So I am very fortunate after my athletic administration career. I jumped into executive recruiting and has been in the industry for about 3 years now. Mm-hmm. And basically we have an opportunity to place folks in the C-suite area, mm-hmm. CEOs, CFOs, and those direct reports like vice presidents, things like mm-hmm. that. And we're based in Chicago. We have about 12 offices throughout the country.
Well, nice.
And I'm here in the Chicago office with about 4 of the guys.
Nice. And you were the AD, right? What things about becoming an AD where you like, man, you know, I think I should try this? Because, Chris, you have your law degree from Notre Dame.
Right.
You're a very smart person. So what led you to want to become an AD?
Well, being a lawyer probably kind of, I mean, having a unique kind of situation, being a former player, having a chance to play on the professional stage as well, mm-hmm. Kind of had all the success in college. Mm-hmm. And when I graduated from law school, the athletic director from Notre Dame kind of approached me and was like, you know, hey, have you ever thought about college administration? Mm-hmm. And, you know, I really didn't. I mean, I didn't see anybody that looked like me mm-hmm. or had the type of representation of folks of color or a lot of women in the athletic departments that I've been around. Notre Dame didn't have any people of color. I believe they had 2 women ADs. So all I saw was white males. And so mm-hmm. I really never thought about it. And mm-hmm. Kevin White, who had this illustrious career, he actually just retired from Duke about maybe 2 years ago. Mm-hmm. But just an amazing, amazing mentor of mine wanted me to think about it. And it was hard for me because I had spent undergrad and law school at Notre Dame. And mm-hmm. he's like, you know, why don't you come back? And I was like, well, can I live in Chicago? And he was like, absolutely not. You have to be here until then. I was like, oh my God, come on, I can't live until then again. But I wound up making that jump. And so I really enjoyed it. Had a chance to kind of see what happens behind the curtain. Mm-hmm. And so from there, although Notre Dame is a place where you really don't have to want for anything, mm-hmm. I knew that if I was going to extend my athletic administration career, I would have to go someplace where I could learn kind of how to fundraise for like serious stuff, like keeping your lights on and for athletic tape and for socks and shoes. So I made the jump to Prairie State and was there for several years and really enjoyed it because, you know, I really wanted the student athletes at every place that I've been to experience kind of the success that I had. And it doesn't necessarily have to mean wins and losses, but kind of what happens outside of that arena. Uh-huh. And so that was really my motivation. I wanted to create environments where our student athletes could thrive.
Well, you know, and Chris, the thing that's interesting about that, in light of the situations that have been in the news with Deion Sanders, what he was trying to do at Jackson State, what Ed Reed was trying to do at Bethune-Cookman, and how that whole thing just went kaplooey over the last week. You've seen the differences between PWI institutions and HBCU institutions. You've seen it firsthand. You've experienced. What did you gather from these two high-profile athletes who went back to historically black colleges and were trying to make a difference? Unfortunately, Ed didn't really get a chance to get in there. But just your thoughts on those two situations when you heard about them.
Well, anytime a former athlete has a chance to go back and either coach or become administrator, I'm 100% behind. Mm-hmm. I really feel as though anytime you have a person who played a sport, really any sport, and the idea behind that is the fact that somebody has to sweat, somebody has to get up 5 o'clock, 4 o'clock in the morning, do those workouts, really kind of understand what it takes to actually be an athlete. Mm-hmm. And so when you have someone who's kind of walked in those shoes and has a chance to be an administrator or a coach, then I'm 100% behind. Mm-hmm. And so I think with two high-profile names having the chance to kind of go into historically black colleges, and you also have to think about Eddie George at Tennessee State as mm-hmm. well. So you think about the exposure that they're going to bring to those institutions as an administrator. That's the reason why you want to find folks who want to come to your place with those high-profile names, because you saw what it did to Jackson State.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, I agree. And, you know, it's unfortunate Eddie, you know, I'm sorry that Ed Reed couldn't get there. And unfortunately how it went kaplooey and became a big public outcry. Just what do you think some of the HBCUs need to do to get more financial resources? Because that's really the major difference, Chris. You know, you can talk all you want, but if you go build a football field, you need some money. You know what I'm saying? Exactly. So, I mean, how do HBCUs get more of the money? One, the ones where they deserve the money from the state, because a lot of them are state institutions, and the ones who are private schools, how do they go out and acquire more funding?
Well, just I'll tell you, if I had the answer to that, every HBCU would be fully funded. Okay. I mean, unfortunately, I don't have that magic pill, but the understanding of obviously having to do with alumni, do you have a strong alumni base? And then also a lot of those institutions rely on state funding. And so now you're talking about supporting your state legislatures, your politicians, knowing where that money is coming from is important. But when you talk about having kind of being able to produce great teams, Lance, and you know about this, it doesn't start with just a coach. I mean, you have to have a great support staff. You have to have a great AD. You have to have a great trainer. You have to have a great secretary. I mean, all these things lead up to having success on the court or field. And a lot of folks who may not really kind of understand how athletics works must understand that there needs to be a support system behind the individuals that are on the court or the field. And I think that's really important. And so when you have, and then outside of that, from AD's point, now you have to have a president that supports athletics. Mm-hmm. And so when you have that, then that's even more important, because now you're going to be able to have those conversations with your president about what's important, the funding that's going on, what's going on with the NCAA legislation. There's so many things that go in to having that relationship with your president. And if your president isn't on board with making athletics successful, then you have an uphill battle.
Yeah, gotcha. And that's something, Chris, I tell people all the time. Like I heard Billy Donovan at Florida say, championships are won with administrators and administration also. So if you don't have the support, Jay, like Chris spelled out, I mean, you're going to be in trouble. So, I mean, Chris is 100% right. You need the support. You need the funding. You need the backing. Then that way you put a good product out there like Chris and them had at Notre Dame, see? Chris and him had backing when he was at Notre Dame. Let me ask Chris this real quick, Jay, if you don't mind. NIL, Chris, name, image, and likeness. Mm-hmm. What's your thoughts on that? And also, if you would have had it at Notre Dame, Chris, you probably would have made millions. A little bit too late. You should go back and ask them for some more money.
Right, yeah, right. It's like retroactive, you know? So in about 2 or 3 years ago, I wrote an op-ed for the Chicago Sun-Times talking about this issue. Mm-hmm. And that's right when the NCAA passed the NIL issue, which literally was a student-athlete can now get value for their name, image, and likeness. Mm-hmm. And so I just basically said that you've opened up Pandora's box, mm-hmm. because you didn't give any legislation. All you said was, hey, you guys can go do it, have at it. Mm-hmm. Well, when you say that, I mean, anything can happen. As you're seeing now, I think there was a kid who was at Florida or he left Florida. Yeah. There was an issue of like $13 million. Uh-huh. This kid hadn't even played yet. And so the idea that there's that type of money out there is just crazy, right? So my solution was that, let me explain the article a little bit. So I talked about what name, image, and likeness was, mm-hmm. and the fact that the universities are really off the hook, which is unfair, right? Mm-hmm. Because when we talk about the NIL, it is a separate entity than that's not associated with the university, mm-hmm. at any place. So their foundations, their booster clubs that are not associated with university, I mean, they may be the Georgia Bulldogs booster club, but technically they're not associated with the University of Georgia. Okay. Mm-hmm. So that being said, the university is kind of clapping their hands a little bit because there's been so much fight about the universities having to compensate the student athletes. Mm-hmm. Well, they're sitting there going, hey, great idea. We love the NIL because they don't have to pay for anything. Mm-hmm. Right. So there's no revenue sharing. There's no, those millions and millions of dollars that Notre Dame makes, they don't have to give that to the student athletes. So that was my first issue, is that, mm-hmm. it's not coming from the university, it's coming from a separate entity. My, mm-hmm. second issue was the fact that the NCAA didn't give you any legislation. They didn't say, hey, you can do X, Y, or Z, which I think is a farce. All they said was, go ahead and allow, we'll do it state by state. So whatever your state decides, that's what you can do. Well, these state legislators have no idea what the hell name, image, and likeness is. They're like, what? I don't even know what that is. Like, you want us to pass something about that? So to make a long story short, I think student athletes should be compensated, but I think the money should be put in a trust, okay. for each individual player. Mm-hmm. Because when you're 18, 19 years old, you know what the hell the value of money is. And God forbid if you came from a situation like me where we don't have anything, we're on public aid. So now you're going to give me $10,000? You're going to give me $100,000? You're going to give me $1 million? I don't know what to do with that.
Spend it, Chris. That's what I'm going to do. We're going to spend it.
Or the option would be put it in a trust, and then now you have the ability to say, okay, you can have this when you become 27, 30 years mm-hmm. old. Now you'll have this nest egg that you were able to create when you were in college and you were able to benefit financially. But I think right now, giving student athletes millions of dollars when they're 18, 19 years old is absolutely crazy.
Yep, I agree. Look, Paul, even your wife has commented. She's like, not a guardian in sight.
I mean, come on now. And then, and I'm only talking the football side. Y'all know the basketball side. Right. The basketball side is crazy. I mean, you have parents who are trying to negotiate deals for the kids.
Yeah, they are.
And their parents don't know nothing. You know what I'm saying? So, and now you have, in some situations, you have kids who may have a mom and dad at the house, may not. May only have a mom. Like, I mean, I grew up in a single parent family. Uh-huh. And so it's only my mom. What does my mom know about negotiating an NIL deal for her kid? Right? I mean, are you kidding me? This is crazy. And so you're just going to sit there and write a blank check for these young kids. It's just not fair.
Yeah, I agree. Well, hey, let's talk about your longtime friend, Kevin Warren, who a couple weeks ago was named the new president and CEO of the Chicago Bears.
Is that amazing?
Funny. Oh, my goodness. I mean, it's just funny, you know, how life works for you. You were his first client as a player. And, I mean, back then, how rare was it for you to even be able to find an African-American agent in the NFL?
I mean, that was, first of all, that was unheard of. I don't even think there, not to my knowledge, I don't even remember seeing any in black agents, let alone me trusting a guy who had just graduated from the Notre Dame's law school and said, hey, I got this idea. You know, I'm like, what? Okay, let me hear it. And be like, okay. But I mean, I kind of joke about that. So basically anyone who's had a chance to see Kevin Warren's press conference when he was hired by the Bears, that's who I met. That's who I knew. And so he is a great salesman because he's speaking truth. Like, nice. I'll tell you about some things that he did that was just unheard of, but the idea that what I saw as a 21-year-old kid was the same thing you guys had a chance to see at that press conference. Mm-hmm. And I was fortunate enough to be there, and you had media in the audience that were getting fired up. Yeah. When was the last time the cynical ass media in Chicago were fired up about something, let alone like the Bears, right? I mean, that was great. But I mean, I say these amazing, I talk about these amazing stories. So for example, each week, Kevin would give me, he would send, because I'm that old that I received fax messages from him, that he would send faxes over to me and he would highlight kind of issues that were in the news for that week. And the idea was, when I was away from the football complex, when I would go to cocktail parties or fundraisers at events, I would have something to actually talk about, as opposed to just saying, well, I play football for the Bears. And so it was that type of mentality that he had for his clients. I mean, yes, I was the first one, but the idea that he was there for me all the time, and he talked about how he would come up to the games and everything. What he didn't talk about was when I first started my foundation, you know, I didn't have a lot of organization. I just went to Jewel and bought a whole bunch of turkeys. And we would put it in the back of a U-Haul truck, and we were passing out food, right? And so he was with me. He was sitting there bagging food in the back of somebody driving a U-Haul truck, knocking it off at people's homes and local churches. It was crazy, man. But that's the type of guy Kevin is. So when he is all in with you, he's in.
Yeah.
And so not only did the Bears hire a great guy, but his resume really speaks for itself.
Yeah.
And people talk about, well, he's never been an NFL president, right? But he's done everything. He's built a stadium in Minnesota, which the Bears are trying to do. And oh, by the way, he's never negotiated a $8 billion media rights deal for the Big Ten, but he did that. And oh, he's never been a college commissioner before. He did that. And oh, by the way, he also brought in USC and UCLA into the Big Ten.
Right.
I mean, this guy is everything you want and more. And I've kind of joked about how the Bears have no idea who they got because he's going to be the first person in there. It may be like 4:30, 4 o'clock in the morning. Mm-hmm. He'll be the first person in the office. And whatever time those players walk out, whatever time the staff walks out, they're still going to see Kevin's car in the parking lot at like 9, wow. 10 o'clock at night. Mm-hmm. That's how much of a hard worker he is. And I kind of joke about this, but I know because from experience, he'll have a couple of suits in his closet at work because there'll be some nights he'll spend the night there and then have to get up for a 7 or 8 o'clock meeting. He'll just go in there, go in the bathroom, take a shower, whatever, put a different suit on. That's the type of president CEO that the Chicago Bears has now.
And you know what, Chris? While that's good, I think that's also the thing that's scaring a lot of Bears fans because you just said it. They don't really know what they have, and I think Bears fans are going, please don't screw this up. Please find a way not to screw this up.
You have to be responsible, right? So when he talked about his press conference, he said that folks might be afraid to talk about championships. It's okay. Championships is a good word. You can walk around saying, we're going to win. We're going to be champions. It's okay to do that. And I think at Hallis Hall, folks don't go around saying that, or if they do, they only kind of whisper it to somebody that they don't like really mean what they say. And the one thing that y'all will like, he was an all-Patriot hooper at Penn. So he's an athlete. He's a former athlete who understands, one, the mentality of athletes. And, oh, by the way, he represented athletes as an agent, and now he's on the other side helping teams get better and build stadiums. So this is definitely a win-win for the Bears.
And you know what, Chris, the thing that I like that you said about him, he's used to building and he used to winning. And that's something that I think the Bears needed, right? What I mean, Chris, did you think that they were going to make a home run hire like they made? Because you was like, they don't know what they got.
You seem like
you still shocked they did it.
Well, I am. I mean, I'm a fan just like everyone else, right? And so I was fortunate enough. My only difference is that I had a chance to play for him for a little bit. So I had a chance to kind of peek behind the screen a little bit. But I've been a fan since I was a kid. And so now understanding that they finally have gotten somebody that had, outside of John Fox, who won a Super Bowl, this is the hire that has more experience than anyone they've ever had before. Even coaches. I think you go back before Mike Ditka, they were hiring assistant coaches. John Fox was the first head coach they had ever hired, but outside of that, everybody's been assistants. And so at this point, you get what you pay for. Okay. If you want a coach that is established, here's a perfect example. How many coaches do you think the Pittsburgh Steelers have had since 1969?
Oh, I know this. It's like four. I'm gonna say like four.
I'm gonna say two. I'm gonna say two.
They've had three.
Three. Okay.
They've had three. Chuck Noll, Bill Cowher, and Tomlinson.
That's it. I knew Chuck, and I knew.
What are they doing? How many coaches do you think the Bears have had since 1960? 30? 35? I mean, what are the Steelers doing that the Chicago Bears can't do? Right. But again, that's talking about really understanding the system, understanding coaches, understanding the league. Mm-hmm. There's no reason why you're one of the founding members of the league and you're currently one of the laughing stocks of the league. And that's really unfair.
That's an excellent point. So in terms of the stadium and stuff, Chris, do you think it's time for them to leave and go to Arlington Heights? You think it's time for a new stadium?
Well, I think what Kevin's looking at, what the Bears are looking at, is how stadiums have advanced, right? Mm-hmm. So now you're talking about hotel complexes, you're talking about restaurants, now you're talking about gaming. So now I used to work for the Chicago Park District. You're not allowed to gamble on Park District property. Mm. So you go to other stadiums, they have rooms with all types of betting going on.
Oh, wow.
You can go to those places in the off season. They have restaurants there. Mm-hmm. I mean, the only thing that that Soldier Field has, I think, are a couple of pro shops. Like you can buy some Bears gear in the off season, but other than that, I'm not sure if they have anything else there that's open. Right. And plus, let's understand, they're renting from the park district. So they rent that stadium for, what, eight home games? I mean, outside of that, I mean, you really aren't creating anything with your own stadium, with the ability to have your own thing. You can now that the value of the Bears, I'm sure, will double. Mm-hmm. I don't know what it is. I think it's like $3 billion right now or something like that. So let's just say it doubles to $6 billion when you create this kind of multiplex where you'll have all these events where you could all of a sudden you could host Super Bowls. You could host Final Fours. I mean, you can do what every other stadium in the country is doing. And, oh, by the way, the guy who built the stadium in Minnesota, which they're doing that, happens to be the person that you hired to be the president of your organization.
All right, we're going to give you a chance to, because you have played for the Bears, you know a lot about them. The thing I think Kevin's toughest challenge is going to be is changing the culture within that organization.
No doubt.
How does he go about doing that? And how much of the family, meaning the McCaskey family as a whole, how amenable do you think they will be to changing that culture?
So when you talk about culture, and this is if you're a coach, I mean, you're an administrator. I mean, Lance, when you first walked into Chicago State as the head basketball coach, you knew you had to change the culture. Mm-hmm. Right? Mm-hmm. And so it wasn't a list that you came in with, oh, X, Y, and, oh, I'm going to do this, this, and this. First, you have to take a kind of a listening tour. Yeah, you have to walk around. You have to see what you have, right? So you realize things you may have or you may not have. So I think the first thing Kevin's going to do is going to walk in and kind of take an assessment of the organization as a whole, but also that culture is the people that are there. So he's going to have those conversations with everybody from the maintenance person to George McCaskey and find out and just ask them. And this is what he said in his press conference. Why aren't we champions? And what do you think it would take for the Bears to be champions? So I think that's the initial stage, because anywhere you go, I don't care what level of coach you are or administrator you are, you can't just walk in and say, oh, this is what I'm going to do. Hey, you guys have to do this. Here's a piece of paper. Boom, it's done. Mm-hmm. You have to measure. You got to see what's going on. You have to see who your best guard is. You have to see who your best administrator is.
Exactly.
You have to see what's going on before you make any decisions. And when I say decisions, I'm not talking about hiring and firing folks. I'm talking about how do you change the culture. Lance, this is one of the things that we kind of talked about. I know you may have forgotten this, but one of the things that was really hard for me to understand was because of some of the financial issues we had at Chicago State, some buildings weren't being cleaned all the time. So, man, I went out there and said, you know what? I went out and bought a vacuum. I went out and bought some brooms. And I put a list together, and I was the first on the list. Said, hey, you know, everybody, so somebody's going to do this. But the idea was when you see an issue, you have to try to address it. And so then that creates kind of the culture, right? So I'm sure they weren't expecting their athletic director to be sweeping the hallways in between meetings and stuff, right? But that's what I was doing, because the place was kind of junky, and which I understand. I mean, you have to move your maintenance staff from building to building. So sometimes our building wasn't getting hit, but you had to go out there and do what you could. So when you talk about culture, I mean, I obviously don't know Kevin's plan, but the idea would be when you'd walk in, you kind of have to assess already the talent that you have and really see what the culture is. It may be, they may walk around saying, hey, you know, we want to win championships. It's okay. I mean, we have no idea, but we can tell from the product that's on the field that they're probably not doing that.
So Chris had to do his own Ed Reed impersonation in Chicago State. He cleaned up his own office. I understand, Chris. We understand.
He's not lying. Because sometimes you have to do what you have to do.
You brought it up. So, and you know, you're a kid from the South Side of Chicago. You played right there at CVS, right there on 87th and Stony Island, and you played at Gately, you played at Eckersall, you played at all those stadiums. and I'm trying to say this with a straight face because it is news. So last week, there was a press conference right around where you grew up. Chicago State announced that they are putting together an exploratory committee because they're going to bring football to Chicago State. And I'm a graduate of the school, grew up there. You've worked there. Lance worked there. My immediate thought is, y'all got to be kidding me. Do you know how much money it costs to do a football program? You need athletic trainers. You need, there's so much stuff than besides just the team itself. So many coaches. Just what was your reaction that they did this press conference just to announce that they're doing this exploratory committee and they're considering trying to bring a football program to the South Side for college students?
Well, first I'm going to start off by saying, as a whole, it's a great idea. Okay. Mm-hmm. I mean, having a chance to have a football program at Chicago State would be great. Okay. So when I was going through the hiring process, apparently there had already been kind of an informal group of guys that got together through the university. I think I saw there was like maybe a 10, 15 page document that they had talked about how can we bring back or how could we bring football to Chicago State? Mm-hmm. And so I hadn't gone through the interview yet, but I'd heard about it. I was trying to kind of get some information. Mm-hmm. And I was hired by the interim president at the time. And we kind of talked about it. And that's why it's called an exploratory committee. Mm-hmm. Because you want to put people on that committee who understands the game. Mm-hmm. Who understands the politics in the area. I mean, so you want to grab some folks from really every different facet of what this sport will touch, right? And I saw some folks. They got some guys from the Bears on there. They got Howard Griffin on there. I mean, that's some really, really important, some great guys. Mm-hmm. But I think what this kind of goes along with what Howard Griffin was talking about, they may not come out with, yes, we're going to have football, but they put together the star-studded cast of folks who will determine if they can have football at Chicago State. Mm-hmm. Now, I think now you have to start peeling back the layers and see, you know, how much you have to raise in fundraising, mm-hmm. how much you're going to get from the NCAA. I mean, it's viable. There are other schools that have done this before. Mm-hmm. So you want to talk to them. You want to understand what things are important, what things can you skip on. I mean, it's just going to be challenging because you want to be able to play on your own field and they don't have a field there, right?
Right.
So the issue becomes, you know, if you're going to have one on campus, where are you going to have it on campus? That costs money. So I think that, and again, at the end of the day, I think having a football at Chicago State would be great.
Right.
But I think this exploratory committee really has to kind of dig deep, and I'm sure they will, mm-hmm. to find out how much this is going to take. Because, you know, Lance, as you and I know, I mean, there have been some challenges historically. There have been some challenges. Mm-hmm. And this is all public knowledge. I mean, I'm not going back and kind of secrets or anything like that. I mean, I think about maybe 6 months before I even got the job, there was an article in the paper about how at one point they only had like 89 freshmen, you know, in a class. So that's a challenge in itself. So I think that they have a lot of information that they need to kind of digest, mm-hmm. and see what's going on. And at the end of the day, I mean, there are some very capable people there. So I think if they can do it, which again, God bless them. I mean, they got some former Bears on there. So they may get some help from the Bears. They got some guys who have won a Super Bowl. I mean, they have all this knowledge on there. So hopefully they'll have a chance to kind of see it at the end. And I don't know if they have a date where they're supposed to report the information to the president, but I think it's going to be encouraging that they have folks who have kind of walked in these shoes before, mm-hmm. because that's extremely important. But at the end of the day, it's about the safety and welfare of our student athletes. Yeah. And if there's any way through this exploratory committee that they find that the standards aren't going to be there or it's going to cost X amount of money, can that money be funneled somewhere else to make mm-hmm. the university better versus just the 85 guys that are going to be on the football team?
Right. Got a couple more minutes here with Chris Zorich as he is joining us. And Chris, let me just ask you real quick. I'm not sure how much you stay in contact with people at the Bears still, but Tanisha Wade has been a very valuable asset, it seems, for the Chicago Bears organization. What do you know about her? And you had spoke earlier about not seeing African-Americans in positions while you were at Notre Dame, and I'm sure you saw that even in your pro career. Just how important is it for us to have a person like Sister Tanisha Wade in the position she's in with the Bears?
Well, when I was with the Bears, I think at that time, Rod Graves, he was with the Bears. I think he was a scout or something like that. So, so to my knowledge, and that was like 30 years ago for me, but that was the only black person that I saw in the building that wasn't a player, right? And so I think that the strides that they've been able to accomplish are important. I've never met Miss Wade, but the idea that they have somebody who is as involved as she is. There was mention of her at the press conference on how she assisted in the search for Kevin Warren. She also assisted in the search for Ryan Pol- for Poles and also for Eberflus when she was there at the front, at the desk, at the table. And really, that's the type of representation that you want, right? Because now you're bringing a different voice to the decision-making process. And I think that's important. Just like having someone who has played, one of the things that I would, if I was on the search committee for the Bears, one of the things that I would have wanted was you had to have NFL experience. Like this is, we're at a time in a day and age where that's extremely important. And the past presidents haven't. I mean, Ted Phillips was not a football person. Mike McCaskey was not a football person at the time, right? So these are people that had no experience, yet they got the jobs. But then they went outside of their sphere, which, I thought was amazing because I didn't think that was going to happen. I thought they were going to name somebody that was close to the organization. But they went way out of their realm and found Kevin, which, again, man, I just can't talk more. I really can't talk enough about what his accomplishments, but also about the person as well. And I think that's really what kind of I'm able to talk about outside of his resume, because at the end of the day, you can kind of see everything that he accomplished. And just on that alone, on his resume alone, he should get the job. But just from a personal aspect that I know him from, he was a great decision.
Let me say this before I ask you another question, Chris. Hopefully Kevin Warren will bring Chris Zorich on to the staff there, because I think you'd be a great asset.
I don't know about that, man. I gotta stay true, man. I've talked about the Bears, and when the Bears sucked, I've dogged them and stuff like that. So if that happens, they're gonna be like, you know what? Man, you're in the community, you know, I don't know what's going on. I don't know if we can hire you.
What you want to qualify for? But let me ask you this. We can't have you on the show without talking about Notre Dame football. How do you think Marcus Freeman has fared in his first year at Notre Dame? They ended the season 9-4. They won a game, I know, a bowl game. I know Notre Dame had won one in a minute. What's your thoughts on Marcus Freeman?
First of all, again, another surprise. the fact that they hired a black coach again, I thought with Tyrone Willingham,
You and me both.
I was like, well, damn it, there's a chance. And this is a high-profile university. I mean, this is not just like some local. I mean, this is Chicago State, right? This is a big stage.
The Golden Dome.
Hey, man, and when you do something here, like that has ripple effects, right? So the idea that they went in-house, and I think it was a unique situation because – and on my podcast, I talked about this because – I just happened to be on the air when Coach Kelly left. And my producer was like, you know, hey, you know, Coach Kelly's gone. Who do you think you need to talk about? Who you think the new head coach should be? And he brought up Marcus Freeman. I was like, there's no way. He's not qualified yet. He hasn't been a head coach yet. And Notre Dame should never be anybody's first head coaching job. I mean, just flat out. Just too much pressure. You have to be established. I mean, it's just a rough go. And he wound up being the guy, right? So then I had him on my podcast. And so I was like, first of all, I had him on before and I had him on after. I said, I just want to let you know, I didn't think you're going to be the choice. He was like, Chris, I didn't either. And he was being honest about it, right? Because, well, I mean, he had only been there for like 11 months.
Uh-huh.
Right. And so, I mean, the only reason why he got the job was because he was a voracious recruiter. I mean, mm-hmm. He recruited like no one else did.
Nice.
And so he was able to get four or five star guys to commit. And they realized that, you know, hey, this guy, he's a really good recruiter. He affects his staff in a way that we become one of the best recruiting teams in the nation. What can he do as a head coach? So, and I'm sure that there were some conversations I had and some things, money and everything else. But the fact that he became the head coach only after being the defensive coordinator for 11 months was shocking to me. He said himself he was shocked too, but he kind of ran with the opportunity. And I think what's so great about Marcus, kind of same thing with Kevin, is that he understands what leadership is about. And more importantly, he understands what he doesn't know. So he's never had head coaching experience before. He goes out and hires a guy that has head coaching experience. Mm-hmm. So this is the head coach at Notre Dame has said, hey, you know what? I don't know something. I've never been a head coach before. Let me go find a guy who has been in the head coaching, that has been a head coach at a couple of different places and bring him in. And that's what he was able to do with Al Golden. And so when you have a leader, when you have a CEO that says, hey, I don't know something, let's bring in somebody that does, that's leadership in itself. Mm-hmm. That's being able to say, you know what? Hey, I don't have to know everything in order to be successful. I think that's what Marcus has done. And I think even year two, which is next year, and year three are even going to be better years for the program.
Wow. All right. Well, hey, everybody. Chris Zorich, was so happy to have you join us tonight, Chris, man. We are so happy. And
absolutely. Thank you.
We look forward to seeing you soon. And tell everybody again the name of the company that you are working with now and the stuff you're doing.
Sure. So I work for Randall Partners. It's an executive search firm. And you can find us on social media at randallpartnersllc.com. And we're able to place executives and those who report to them. But I also have a college football show that kind of Lance mentioned. Our season is over now, but would love to have a chance maybe even have you guys on. I'll be talking about like the top 15, or excuse me, the top 16 college football teams in the nation.
I love college football, Chris.
There we go.
Love it. But Chris, really, really quick, is it true when you was in high school at CVS, St. Rita did not want to play you guys? Because our producer, Sean, went to St. Rita, and I told him that he – Chris, would you please tell him St. Rita didn't want to play you guys?
Okay. I'm not sure exactly about that story, but all I know is that at me, that time, it was a public school and it was Catholic school. And y'all understand that mix. I mean, so this was mid to late 80s. There were a lot of things that we didn't have. Like, so for example, thank God we're at a vocational school, because our football coach, John Pataki, actually went to Mount Carmel. Actually, after his career, yes, he went back to Mount Carmel. Ooh. But we didn't have a weight room. So down in the basement, he created a weight room for us. And all we had were those Nautilus machines, you know, that you can kind of
you do 1975 Bally stuff, yeah, from Bally.
Yes. Well, which I'm sure that's probably where we got it donated from. So he actually ripped that apart, and he used the actual weights for like dumbbells. So we were at a vocational school. So he took a whole bunch of metal to the machine shop, and they welded weights for us. And so we were getting big and everything, but our weights looked like rectangles from the thing that had the cords on there. I mean, it was crazy. So I only say that to say that we really didn't have a lot of like amenities. And so every time we played at Catholic school, they would just beat the crap out of us, because we really didn't have what it took to be successful. Can I kind of talk about before, it takes leadership from the top to kind of help the program down.
Chris, y'all would have whooped St. Rita. Chris, y'all would have beat St. Rita.
I don't know. Chris knows. Chris played with my guy, John Foley. John Foley was the number one high school player in the country.
Yes, coming out of
my freshman year. I'm practicing for basketball, and they're doing a photo shoot. USA Today is in the gym, the old St. Rita gym, if you remember, Lance and Chris. The old small St. Rita gym. They had one corner, and they had a big white tarp, and he's in his game uniform, and they had a little photo shoot with him. So Chris knows about St. Rita. He knows about it.
Absolutely.
Chris, you messed it.
I got to tell the truth, man. Here's another funny fact. This is interesting. So Holtz's first class, he went and got like half the guys on the team were from the Chicago Catholic League.
Stan Spagala.
It was crazy. Stan Spagala, Tim Grunhardt. I mean, however, only half of those guys ever made it. The other half, they got kicked out. I don't know why, what happened there, but.
And how many were Prop 48s? Because that's when Prop 48 was in. Because John was a Prop 48 guy. Because we didn't realize that he was dyslexic. So that's why I know everyone growing up, everyone thought John was just dumb. But John and he was like, just a big dumb football player. But he actually had a learning disability, which was dyslexia. So once they figured that out, it's like, he just learns differently. And then he, that's how. But I remember he would come back all the time, and he would tell us about the. Just the atmosphere at Notre Dame. Dame was huge over here where I grew up. Right down the street from John.
Chris, you probably missed it earlier, but Lance Irvin said that he threw down a challenge earlier in the weight room that he could beat Sean Sierra, and that he used to give you a run for your money in the weight room. And I think my cousin has lost his damn mind challenging two football players in weightlifting. Would you like to comment on that?
Here's the thing I do remember about Lance.
Talk to me, Chris.
There were times when I'd get in the office early, and I'd see another car in the parking lot. I'm like, "Well, whose car is that?" Then all of a sudden, you see Lance sweating in the weight room. I'm like, "What time did he get there?" So I do have to say that there were times when he was out there doing his thing before anybody else got there, which I was very, very impressed by.
See, staring late, but Chris, I said this, and I'm going to let Chris go. I said, just because you and Sean kind of big and y'all look muscular, I said, y'all big, I'm wiry strong, so I can keep up with you guys. So I'm challenging you, Christopher Zorich, and Sean Sierra, the fullback. We're going to meet one day. We're going to film it, and we're going to go lift it. Do I have a deal? Do I have a deal? Mr. Zorich, Mr. Sierra, do you have a deal?
I'm in, man.
I got three letters for you. Bet.
I'm in.
Bet.
Chris said we in. So, Sean, we gonna set it up. And Chris, you gonna meet us. Jason, you gonna come since you look like you don't left.
Oh, I'm gonna video this one. I'm the camera operator for this.
Chris, we appreciate you being on, Chris.
Absolutely, man. I'm looking forward to being on again. Thanks, guys.
Good soldier, everybody. Thanks, Chris. All right, hey, coming up, we gonna talk with a young entrepreneur in our community, guy YB from Young Ballers TV. Oh my God, I can't wait to talk to this dude. Woo. He's been waiting behind stage for us. We appreciate that. We're going to take a quick commercial break, and then we'll be right back with Young Ballers TV CEO and entrepreneur, YB.
That you're in my lane?
No, not at all.
Are you not paying attention? Are you texting?
I was just checking in with my mom. I was telling her that I thought we'd be home by 6.
It's okay. There's enough time. Just pay attention.
I'm not even halfway through my text. There's no way. I'm not even going to look up.
My babies are in the car. You have to pay attention.
It's just supposed to be a quick text. I'm so sorry.
Operator 901, where's the emergency?
127 Vermeer.
Okay, what's going on there?
I'd like to order a pizza for delivery.
Ma'am, you've reached 911. This is an emergency line.
Large with half pepperoni, half mushroom.
You know you've called 911. This is an emergency line.
Do you know how long it'll be?
Okay, ma'am. Is everything okay over there? Do you have an emergency or not?
Yes.
And you're unable to talk because...
Right, right.
Is there someone in the room with you? Just say yes or no.
Yes.
Okay, it looks like I have an officer about a mile from your location. Are there any weapons in your house?
No.
Can you stay on the phone with me?
No. See you soon. Thank you.
Welcome back, everybody, to What's Up, Cuz. I'm your host, Jason Palmer, along with my cousin, the coach himself, Lance C. Urban. And coming up in just a few minutes, we're going to have our guy, YB, from Young Ballers TV. He's going to come on and tell us a little bit about what he's got going on. He had to step out for just a minute there, but can't wait to have him back as well. Wow, that was fun with Chris Zorich. That was a lot of fun, and I'm definitely going to be there when you guys do this weightlifting thing. I'll be the paramedic in case things get out of hand, people get injured, somebody pull something or twist something. Then, you know, I'll be there to assist, but I'm also going to be there to document because I can't wait to see you and your wiry strength challenge Chris Zorich and Sean. So, we'll see.
You know what, Jason? You kind of like being disrespectful to your cousin. If I would talk the talk, I could walk the walk. But, you know, it's glad to see that Sean accepted the challenge. And I'm glad to know that Chris accepted the challenge.
Yeah, so we'll look forward to that.
You know, I'm not running from nobody.
Good. Sounds good. You ready to bring YB on? Because I'm ready.
AJ, and we apologize for having YB waiting in the waiting room so long because Christopher Zora jumped on late. But you know you large, Jay, in a community when people, they don't call you by your government name. They just say YB. Like YB. And it dawned on me, I've been calling them YB so long, Jay. I was like, hey, what's your real name? He has one of the hottest things that he does for the community, for the schools and area. Yes. Like he goes to games, Jay. He like shows the basketball game live. He gives commentary. He does stuff each and every night, a couple of days a week where he talks about the sport. He have young athletes in the community. They jump on and they talk to YB. And he knows every good basketball player in the city and in the state. If YB doesn't know you, Jay, you can't play. You're not that good. No, seriously. You're not that good. And I had it, man. YB has about, Jay, he's so large, he has about 30,000 followers. And he understands what he's talking about. So I had to bring him on the show. And now, Jay, we got to find out how he got started, how he became so large in the community. But if you want your kid to get exposure in basketball, you need to call and get to know YB. Let's bring him on, YB, Sean.
YB, what's up, man? How you doing?
Yo, am I on?
You are on, sir.
All right, cool.
I mean, I gave you a big time introduction, YB. and I'm sitting there, you know you cold when everybody just call you by YB. Just like YB at the game is YB at the game. Seriously, I asked Kobe and Nick one day. We were sitting there talking years ago, and they said something. I said, YB, what the hell y'all talking about? They're like, you don't know YB? I said, oh, my fault, that YB. I forgot. So anytime you see a game, but YB, talk to us how you first got started doing these basketball games and having people every day on your show talking about basketball.
Man, I originally started with Small Fry. Small Fry basketball, you know, it's like for the short kids. It's a whole backstory with it, but I just say I started with Small Fry and I went and I just locked in and they built like every day. I mean, every weekend I just stayed locked in with it and gradually moved from like Small Fry to like AAU, middle school ball, high school basketball. I roughly came in like around the time Charlie Moore was the senior, like when he was on his way out is when I really hit the scene. I hadn't even really hit high school yet. So, you know, that's one of the main things. And then I just kind of just stayed locked in. Like, a lot of those same kids I'm talking about right now are in college right now doing their thing. You know what I'm saying? And then stay locked in with the next generation. And I just kind of do it like, it's like I'm an entrepreneur. I got a business, an LLC for it. But then, like, man, it's really like just a great hobby, man. Like, you know, I have fun with it, you know?
Because, like, when you first started, right? And I remember you at Morgan Park because the people used to say, hey, you know, y'all games on YB, y'all games on YB. So, what actually happened when you said, you know what? Let me do this so I can get the word out.
It started with me, like, at first, when I first started, I wasn't as vocal. Like, I kind of built up, like the lives and all the commentary. Like, it's not like a lot of cameramen that do that. You know, most of them don't say nothing, man. They just film and be quiet. But me adding my voice is like another element. And I could just give my insight and what I think and like reactionary stuff, and commentary. And that's where the live stream came from. I have,
Because you say some crazy stuff on your live. you say some stuff like no other, Jay. Why Ben be filming the game and just start saying like, oh, he garbage. Like, he blocked that shot. They better come on. You better come on with that right now. They gonna get run up out of here. Like, he'll say some crazy stuff. And I'm sitting there cringing. I'm like, but he did tell the truth, though.
Yeah, I got this thing where I tell the truth. Like, I'm impartial with it. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't have no favorites or nothing like that. I mean, I got my favorites, you know, because they, you know, I started off with certain players, of course, you know, I love watching them play, but overall, I don't even know them, like, and I gotta be that way. So, and everybody knows equal. So once they really get to know me, it's like they don't take it personal because I'm on that with everybody, you know.
Right.
You know, it's all performance based. You know, is you buckets don't grow on trees. You know what I'm saying? You got to put that work in, and you can't cheat this game. It's gonna the proof gonna be in the pudding. You know, we gonna see. And a lot of people be talking. And when the game time come, those numbers and the score is going to tell a story. And I'm sitting back eating my popcorn, watching and waiting, because a lot of people say a lot of stuff to me. And sometimes when I get there, it's like, it'd be a different story, man.
Hey, well, let me ask you this. What has been the reaction of parents of a lot of these players when they see their son or daughter on your channel?
It depends on what side are they on. Are they the one doing the highlight, or are they on the side of the ones being performed against, you know, on the highlight tape on the other end of it? It depends on what side the parent is on. Sometimes it'd be tough, man, you know, because, like, you know, the parents really, they feelings being this, they invest a lot into it, and they know that, like, my platform, I could, like, reach far. So sometimes if I post something, they kid and not the best light because another kid outperformed them for one reason or another, and I expose that on my platform, it sometimes it be kind of, it has been harsh, you know. And I just tell them, it's like, it's not like this show business. Like, you know, sometimes that happens. Like, so you might be on either side of it sometimes, you know what I'm saying? It just depends. I mean, I just hope people appreciate that about me, you know, the impartial aspect of it, you know.
And, you know, I'd be one of the things, you know, I say, you know, as a person who's a journalist and been a journalist for over 20 years here in Chicago, what has happened is a lot of our newspapers and places that used to cover high school sports consistently, they stopped covering it. Like, they only cover the major games now. They don't cover a lot of stuff. I think people like you are stepping in and filling that void and really shining a light to keep the Chicago basketball tradition going. Do you see yourself kind of in that light as well?
Yeah. I want to ask you, why is that? Why did they step back? Like, what's going on with that? Like,
yeah, I think a lot of it was budgetary reasons. I think a lot of newspapers started losing a lot of money when the internet really blew up. Nobody reads the newspaper, but no more. Everybody looks online. But I also think it's been a failure on the part of the journalism community, because high school athletics is local news. Mm-hmm. And I think you have to cover local news and community news before you cover a lot of this other stuff. And I think what you're doing is you're directly going into some of these communities who have been forgotten, and you're highlighting some really positive stuff that's going on.
Yeah, and that's why it's like, and they have, and they failed us, and that's kind of why I act the way I act, man. I be kind of acting out sometimes, how Lance was saying, and I get on my platform and start talking a little crazy, because it's like, man, y'all failed us, man. Now I done created this whole platform here by myself, and y'all still not supporting. And some, it's crazy, because like some of the top people will look for me to just support, and they don't, but like, I don't know, a lot of Chicago don't really give back like that, you know? Mm-hmm. And that's interesting. Even our NBA players, like, they just don't seem, like, interested. Like, I know they busy with their stuff they got going on, but, like, I don't know. It just seemed like a nice hobby or whatever, just to be a little bit more involved. And, like I enjoy doing that. Like, I seen a kid that was getting kind of scolded by his dad. Is that me? Mm-hmm.
That's one of y'all. That's one of yours.
Oh, that's Josh Christopher right there.
Okay, there you go.
See, that's why we started the platform, YB, yeah. to get word out and let people see people that's doing well in the community, but not only doing well in the community, but doing well across the country. And your stage is really good, kind of like you and Jason was just talking about. Like, sports used to be on the back page of every newspaper, on the front page in the newspaper, right? Now you really don't see it like we used to. So that's why I'm happy you doing what you're doing to keep at least Chicago basketball out there. You do AAU also, but you have been and watched a lot of games, right? What's the best game you remember doing? Give me your favorite. Or if it's two, give me your top two.
It's hard to put them into so many games. I can go this year that shoot, that Moline game, man. Who did Moline just play? It's a kid named Brock.
They just play Simeon? They just play Simeon.
Yeah, that one. Real good. Yep. And,
but see, I got a bone to pick with you, because I thought you was going to say the Battle of Vincennes. Like, you thinking real hard, like you don't want to say the Battle of Vincennes, where Nicholas and Rob Smith was coaching against each other. I'm going to call Nick on you in a minute.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, no, you like, oh, yeah. Come on, man.
Yeah, no, I just went to this year, but definitely the Battle of Vincennes, like my YouTube page, like that, those, I look at my little residual check. I get a little YouTube check, nothing too major, but the, like the residual on my Battle of Vincennes, like people still go back and watch it. I get them little extras off that, like over time, like they still do numbers for real. Like,
for real? I didn't know that.
Yeah. So man, you know, I missed that era, man. That was a great era of basketball for sure, man.
Name me a couple of your favorite players that you actually like to see. You could do this year, you could do whatever.
Let me name a couple of my favorite coaches real quick.
Go ahead. Let's get it then. Go ahead. That's why you on here. Go ahead.
Like, I love Nick Urban. Like, I got the to me, like, I use these coaches in my personal life. They the things that they do, and in my business, like Nick Urban can really motivate kids well. Like, he know how to, you know, like, get yours, young fella. You know what I'm saying? That's what you say. Like, and having somebody like that behind you, really believing in you, like, can make you play at a higher level than you might not normally play. Like, it's a difference. Mm-hmm. And then that you know, that poor man to Mike Urban too, you know, his style, like a lot of people, you know, they kind of give Mike Urban some grief, but like, I ain't got no problem with Mike Urban, because it's like, man, he bring that competitive edge in the game. So it's like the way he like speak up and say what he got to say, like, I got that in me too. So I identify with Mike Urban with this. So, man, I be telling people, be cool, man. I know y'all want to see him lose, man. Because he doing stuff like bringing people to, he brought Cam in, the top player in the nation, to Chicago. Like, he doing stuff that, you know, a lot of other people ain't out here doing in Chicago amidst all of the political things going on, you know, in the basketball world or whatnot. So, mm-hmm. you know, giving them kids that exposure on that type of platform. Mm-hmm. And of course, Rob Smith. Rob Smith is a cool, you know, laid back boss type. He ain't gonna say too much. He'll get on his disciplinary time. He like stern, old school, but mm-hmm. he adapted to the new ways of how things go, and he understand how like the media stuff go mm-hmm. and that. So he like locked in with that. So that's why I really what I rock with about Rob Smith. Ty Slaughter, with the young coach. He's like he's another one. He cool and laid back, and he's so intelligent, and he witty and funny. Like, man, and I always got he always come like I was saying some jokes. So I got a joke me and him got this ongoing joke because on one of my old videos, I don't even know which one it was. I'm still looking for it. I was like, it's looking like it's gonna be a burial out here because somebody was losing. Like, get your shovel. So then he's saying that, and he always say that back to me. And he'll talk to me about if it's going to be a burial and somebody getting blew out. So, yeah, like, so Ty's my man. And, mm-hmm. And Mike Oliver, too. Because Mike Oliver crazy. You better not mess with him, right?
So what about players, Wabi? Talk to some players this year that you think people should go out and see.
So the coaches' players. Let me start back. So I said Mike Urban first day on Mike Urban team, right?
Okay.
Man, they got a great – first of all, okay, let me talk about the day Mike Urban dynamic. The fact that Mike Urban let day scored them, 65 points? You know, mm-hmm. it was a lot of political people was mad about that. Hey, man, they was mad for real. Like, how you just gonna blow that team out of 100-10? Ethical. Know what I'm saying? But at the end of the day, and that was during Christmas break, but what happened? Yeah. But during the Christmas tournament at Proviso, but at the end of the day, Day got his name up there in the nation for the most points scored. Like, that stuff is important still, man. Like, he up, like, it's another player that had, like, 62, and a player that had, like, 59. Let Day name be up there, man. He could have let him go for 80 or something. You know, and he could have. He took him out. He would have went for 80 on the Edison. And, you know, that would have looked real crazy, I know, because... So yeah, and Day, man, he one of my favorite players too right now because he got that sauce. He got fundamentals and he got that sauce, and he been working on his right hand, your left hand. he been finishing with his right hand. Man, straight, he was getting buckets against the number one player in the country, DJ Wagner, DeJuan mm-hmm. Wagner. So yeah, and Kansas State commit, right. And then I could talk about Jalen Griffin. He the point guard leader this year. Him and he got a nice thing going with the two bigs, the Rubin brothers, Wesley Rubin is Wesley Miles Rubin.
Wesley.
Mm-hmm. Right, the Loyola commit, and Wesley is the
Northern Iowa.
Northern Iowa commit, right. Yep, so that's huge right there. And they just got a nice thing going. They got upset by Curie last week, but they came back to beat, something Central in Missouri school that was 19-0. They just knocked them off and gave them their first loss, a solid team.
Let me ask you this, since you're talking about different teams. You know the city playoffs are starting.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, good question. The playoffs are
starting.
Uh-huh.
Who's your pick to win city this year?
Well, it's on the four brackets, man. It's hard for me to just pick who gonna win city, but I could dive into the final four pretty much. Where is that?
Dive into it.
Okay, man. I need. Where
you
is
remember
that?
Now? Whitney Young and Curie. I mean, I think either Simeon or Whitney Young might be in the same bracket. Yeah. It's either Whitney Young or Curie. It might be Whitney Young and Curie in the same bracket.
Yeah, so that is and that why that basically that dynamic is going to affect the Final Four for mm-hmm. sure. You really don't know who going to do what in that situation.
You know, pick one. I just said how you pick one, either Young or Curry. Don't be nice. Pick one.
Oh, man, look, man.
Oh, Jay, now you're going, oh, let's go.
Look, it's hard. I can say that I know that, okay, we know that Simeon is going, with Simeon being the first ranked and then first seed and then North Lawndale being the second. I'm giving that to Simeon on that bracket. And then on this other bracket, you got Westinghouse number one, Hyde Park two. So Hyde Park and then Lindblom is four with the kid with Jayshon Stevenson who's actually leading the Red South Horn this year. So Hyde Park Hyde Park realistically can make it to the Final Four. Really. Okay. And that's something right there. Because of the way the seeding fell was really in Gerald Oliver's favor. And I could talk about Gerald Oliver too. He one of my favorite coaches too, because he got that Mike Oliver toughness with his uncle, but then he got like a certain like.
Hey, Jay, you see how YB staying away, trying not to answer his Final Four? You real good, YB. This is the first time I heard YB, the cat got his tongue. Hold on. Said, who you picking? Don't try to get me.
Okay, look, so that's come on. Hyde Park. Yeah, so I'm going with Hyde Park.
Okay.
And then Kenwood. Out of this one, because they got to get past basically Phillips and Farragut, so they should handily get past those two. And then on this one, I just don't know between Young and Cure. I don't know.
I'm disappointed in you, YB.
Who you got out of one. Young, out of Slaughter, and Mike Oliver? It's hard to tell with that one, man.
I mean, either way, you can't go wrong.
Like, man, these kids be unpredictable, man. That's why we're
All right, so who you picking to win City? City. Who you picking to win City?
Man, that's the same thing.
Oh, JYB. Normally he outspoken, Jay. He waited to come on our podcast night. Quiet.
Volatile, man. That's why I got a FanDuel account and I gamble and make my picks and selections on adult grown men, professional hoopers. Not these kids, man, because these kids is streaky. One of them game, then the other one. What,
hey, Roach. YB doesn't want to give us a selection pick, Roach. Roach, I'm gonna bring you on to give us his pick, Roach. I'm gonna bring you on next week, Roach.
Oh, what Roach pick. Got? Oh, Roach listening to me, man.
Yes, Roach is listening to you. Oh, yeah. He's disappointed you don't want to give us a pick. Bro,
man. Okay. Yeah, it's hard. Roach can't give a pick either. Is he commenting?
Yes, he commenting. Yes, he's commenting. That's his comment. Man. Go ahead, Jay. Go ahead, Jay. I'm going to let you take YB off the hot seat, Jay. Go ahead. Okay. Take him off the hot seat.
I'm all right. Well, YB, tell everybody where they can follow you on Instagram and on Twitter.
Okay. Both of them are the same. Instagram and Twitter are Young Ballers TV. That's YoungBallerz TV.
Where will you be this week? What games are you going to
Great question.
This week we're looking at we're gonna decide on really the main games, the city games, like early on, like these games, like Young versus Emerson and Curry versus Chaz, you know, Simeon versus Catalyst Maria. You know what I'm saying? These like highlight games, right? So it's like go to those games to collect highlights. You're not finna get a real battle or nothing like. And I anticipate the battles, you know. Like the Final Four and then that one Elite Eight game between Curry and Young is gonna be a battle, you know. And I think that game will be February 7th. So that's like it. That's down the line. But this week,
St. Rita play D. LaSalle this week too.
Yeah, but that ain't one of my games right there. That's just, you know what I'm saying? This week, and speaking of the Catholic League, we have Brother Rice, who lost to St. Rita, playing Mount Carmel, who beat St. Rita. And
Mount Carmel. Boo. What up, Young? Okay. YB, I'm a St. Rita grad. That's why I'm talking shit. That's
okay. All. Oh, yeah, okay, no, I can get on his St. Rita, man. They they got a lot to prove still, man. Like, they got to get it together because they got some top players and they ain't really been able to pull things together. So, St. Rita against, who y'all say St. Rita? Yeah, De La Salle.
De La Salle.
Okay, but yeah.
They got the issue with them is that they got a lot of players. They got that kid from Lamont. So they got, but they also played a national schedule. So it's not like they're playing local teams. Local teams, you're going to have a chance to kind of gel because you're not always going to get that same type of talent. But when you're on a national schedule, you got to bring your A game every day. And they haven't begun to develop it as soon as we would have liked. However, come playoff time, I think that schedule that we played is going to come handy. And then next year, because remember, we got the top three juniors in the state. Next year, when they're seniors, all that, you know, chemistry stuff, that should be out the door, and they should be ready to roll. We should be a contender for the state title next year, real talk.
What's your name?
The Sean.
That's our producer, Sean. The super back's here.
That's the super back.
So are we keeping it all the way real about everything right
now? Yeah, keep it all the way real. We don't want you pulling punches, man.
Well, like, basically the scenario you explained was a similar scenario from last year, first of all. I want this St. Rita coach to get it together and figure it out because last year you lost some good players. You lost Caden Space to Simeon. You lost Jaden Rayner to Bishop Knoll. So my thing is this, and this year you say a national schedule, but you lost a couple local games that you wasn't supposed to lose, like Proviso East.
No State. Yeah, I was there.
One or two other games in there, like you supposed to. So basically, man, this to me, this coach, you got to get it together now, ain't it? It's now or never, because these players they move around on you.
I agree with you. I just think we need Sean
to get YB to come out and be real like he always is. Good job, Sean. We're going to pull it out of him. There you go. Hey, all right. We are out of time, fellas. We have come to the end of the show. Another great episode.
YB, I call you. Appreciate you.
Thank you so much, YB, for joining us, man. Everybody tune in to him, all right?
I appreciate it, man.
All right, take care.
Thanks. Peace.
But you know what? I can't leave just yet. I got like 1 minute. But I got to do this. I have to do this because it's very important. And I promised two important cousins that I would do this. Sean, I don't know if you know it, but unfortunately, we have to give Lance his props today.
Boy.
We have to give you your props because in a couple of days, happy birthday, Lance Herman, a.k.a. Morris Chestnut. And your lovely family sent us some wonderful pictures of you. That's you showing off them bad knees with your daughter, Brooklyn. And then I had to pick this photo because it's you and your lovely wife, Paula. And I think it's at my wedding. So I had to throw that picture up. But happy birthday to you, old knock-kneed Lance Herman.
Because I appreciate it, man. And, you know. Getting a year older, you know, Morris Chestnut sent me a shout out. He sent me a gift for the house. So, you know, no, I appreciate Jay. And, man, I thought we had a great show because, you know, I thought Chris YB kind of held his tongue, though. But, you know, he was good, Jay. We had a great show, but I'm looking forward to spending my birthday. GG, I appreciate because we got to have G on the show to talk about the Bears. Yeah. GG, we're going to have you on the show one day to talk about the Bears because she's one of the young ladies, Jay. She loves the Bears, and she understands about sports. Kitty Mac. Oh, Paula's Kitty Mac hero. Unbelievable. It's not Paula's birthday. It's my birthday, Kitty Mac. appreciate you. Appreciate you, cuz.
Yeah, happy birthday. What are you doing for your birthday, Wednesday?
You know, we have a game, so, you know, Jay, I never have an off day when I don't play on my birthday. I can't remember in college, high school, not playing on my birthday. I should miss the game so I could sit at home and just reminisce. But now, being at the game, Jay, so we get us a win, and hopefully Paula going to take me out to a nice restaurant on Saturday night. So maybe she'd take me out to, like, RPM, or maybe she'd take me out to 9 or one of those type places.
Nobody want to hang with you on your birthday.
Maybe you might take me to the gun range. Hell.
You know why we don't hang with you? Because it's too damn cold on your birthday. It's going to be minus 12 degrees Wednesday.
You know what? I just can't win. Just
that's your problem. I'm gonna take care of you, though. I'm gonna hook care. Not this year, but one of these years, I'm gonna take care of y'all. And on that note, because we only got 20 seconds left and I gotta end the show, which means we can't even do the Black National Anthem, so we just gonna say we'll see you next week for more guests. Thank you for watching. What's up, cuz? Happy birthday. I love you, cuz.
Peace. Peace.